Okay, so we're going to begin. We're holding in the middle of Perek Revi'i. We're going to finish, actually, Perek Revi'i, the fourth chapter of Kohelet. And we're going to go on to the beginning of Perek Hamishi, the fifth one. Last week, we spoke about jealousy and the problems that mankind has, amongst others, is that he's jealous. And that jealousy brings about all kinds of consequences, some good and some bad. Most of the time it's bad, it's negative. But that is what drives people to do all kinds of things. And jealousy in itself, in general terms, is an indication that the individual lacks emunah, lacks bitachon, lacks the proper faith and reliance on God. He obviously is unhappy. He has perhaps many complaints. He wants things that he believes he should have. And now Shlomo Melech is going to tell us about the value of something that is the exact opposite of kina, and that is sechel, brains, common sense, something that people do not unfortunately use enough, and that is common sense. They don't stop and think. Even though he's talked a little bit about this before, that people don't stop and think about creation, stopping and thinking also involves other things in life. It involves evaluating one's actions. It involves evaluating one's speech before you speak, before you say something. Sechel, proper management of one's affairs in life, one's conduct, one's marriage and relationship, requires sechel. Because sechel is what will be necessary to make our best choices, to use good judgment. Even though we've spoken a lot about Mazal, Mazal is something that runs the world and runs our life, things that are beyond our control. Nevertheless, a great deal of our actions depend on proper use of our sechel. And the more knowledgeable one is, the more one is not materialistic and enslaved by bodily desires and instincts, but he uses his sechel, he has a better chance of being successful in many areas of life. So he begins to say as follows: Tov yeled misken v'chacham mimelech zaken uchsil asher lo yada lizaher od. If you read the pasuk by itself, it doesn't make too much sense to you, unless you read the commentaries. He's saying that a young boy, a yeled, is better off, even though he's a misken, he's poor. V'chacham, but he's smart. He's better off than a melech, than a king, who's a zaken, who's old and feeble, weak, uchsil, foolish, asher lo yada lizaher od, who can no longer take care of himself, can no longer be as careful or cautious in running his kingdom, in managing his life. It is very enigmatic. In other words, it's not a very clear pasuk. What is he talking about, that a child can be better off than a king? Now, we do know that a small little animal that is alive is better than a dead lion. And there's a saying similar to that in various languages, that something that is alive, no matter how small it is better than something that is dead, no matter how big it is. Well, obviously. But so what's the point over here, that a child who's a chacham is better off than a king who's a zaken, who's old, and he's exil, he's foolish? Rabbis tell us that one of the explanations of this verse has to do with the Yetzer Hara and the Yetzer HaTov. The Yetzer HaTov, the good instinct, the good inclination, is compared to a young child who's wise, but he's young. The Yetzer Hara, the evil, the negative inclination that all of us have, is compared to a king who is old, who's been around for a while, but he's exil. He's a fool. Even though the Yetzer Hara knows how to fool us, he himself is also a fool. What good is that information? Well, once we know that the Yetzer Hara is a fool, it is meant for us to understand that you can therefore beat him. You can therefore overcome him. Don't think that he's so smart that he's impossible to fight, that he's impossible to defeat. If you use your sechel properly, if you allow the Yetzer HaTov to rule, with the sechel, with the tov that the Yetzer has, the Yetzer tov, you will be able to overcome the ra, that which is evil, that which is driving you from birth to want things, to be selfish, right? So it is possible to overcome it. That's a very important message. In other words, don't think just because you have certain habits, certain inclinations, certain characteristics, just because an individual is born like that, like some people would like to say, I was born like that. It's in the genes. So what? If we understand free will properly, so free will, if it is guided with the proper sechel, it will hopefully make the right choices. And even though it may be difficult, yes, because of genes, call it whatever you want. So what? No matter what a person has, if it is character related, it is controllable. It can be overcome. So here, the Yetzer Hara is been around for a while because he's there from birth. When does the Yetzer Tov arrive? Bar Mitzvah only. The good inclination only arrives at the age of Bar Mitzvah. The Yetzer Hara has been there from the very start. So therefore, this Yetzer Hara is almost like a Ba'al HaBayit. He's almost like he owns you. And because he owns you, the child has already become accustomed to many, many habits that have been formed from childbirth until the age of 13. So the Yetzer Hara in some ways has an advantage over the Yetzer HaTov that comes late in the game. He's already been around, right? Nevertheless, this Yetzer Hara can be defeated. How? With Sechel. Now this Sechel, he tells us in the next Pasuk, Ki mi bet hasurim yatsa limloch, from the very exit of the womb. That's one explanation of what the word surim. It is also like haasurim, which is the jail, which can also be referring to the womb, because the little baby is like in a jail. So from the very first stage, the very first breath that the infant took, already from that point on, Yatsa Limloch is already a king. He already has abilities. He's limited, however, ki gam bimalchuto nolad rash. Even though he's a king, in other words, he's no longer imprisoned, he's a living being, nevertheless, bimalchuto, as he is becoming a king, he, during the early stage of his life, this child is rash. He's a poor man. He's a poor boy. As we said before, a misken. Because the Yetzer Hara has been there longer than him, right? So even though he has the sechel, and therefore he's a king, this king at the first steps of his life is like a rash, is like a poor man. He's not able to carry out everything that he would like to. Now this is a very important idea, because it explains to us why the Bar Mitzvah is only at the age of 13 and not earlier. Why isn't Bar Mitzvah earlier? Why did the rabbis tell us that Bar Mitzvah occurs at the age of 13? And for a woman, it's at the age of 12. What's so magic? What's the magic number of 12 or 13? Well, why not 10? Why not make a child responsible to put on tefillin and to keep the mitzvot when he's 9 years old? After all, 9 years old, he knows how to communicate well. He knows right from wrong. He's not a 3-year-old. At least 9. Well, what's so special about 13? Anybody want to suggest? I mean, what's so unique about that stage? What happens when you have a Yetzer Tov and a Yetzer Ra together?
Can I say something?
Yes, go ahead.
Physically,
it
is in full growth. That's why at age 13, a boy has Bar Mitzvah.
He has become more mature.
No, not,
is that what you're saying?
Not only mentally, physically
right?
Too.
Yeah, yes, of course, yes, obviously. We are aware that that's what happens then. But what would have been wrong to give him mitzvot
sooner?
Or why not introduce the Yetzer HaTov, which is the good inclination, right? Sooner, Hashem says, I wait till I bring the Yetzer HaTov to the age of 13. Why not bring it sooner? So I once explained that as follows. Perhaps the reason for this is as follows. Whenever you have the two together, which you do after bar mitzvah, and you have a situation that you have to decide, should I do this or should I not do this? You have Yetzirah Tov telling you yes, Yetzirah telling you not, depending on what it is, if it's a good deed or a bad deed. This causes a struggle, right? This causes hesitation. You have to think about it. The mind has to begin to work to process the information. Should I do it? Should I not do it? Gotta use your judgment. The child is not mature enough, like you said, at that point to handle this challenge of decision making. If you were to introduce the Yetzer HaTov at the age of 9, could you imagine what would be going on in the child's mind? One is pulling this way, one is pulling that way. The child cannot handle decision making, which involves listening to both sides, right? The good and the bad, too early, when he's too young. It's just too much for him. Well, then why send the Yetzer Hara? Don't give him a Yetzer Hara. Yetzer Hara is with the child from the very beginning, because that is the driving force of many things in a human life. For example, to eat, to sleep, that also is Yetzer Hara. That is a selfish, in a way, in a good way, the selfish engine or drive that a human being needs to have. A little bit of self-esteem, certain wants. So you have to have that from the very beginning. But you see the problem. The problem is the Yetzer Hara has been there longer than the Yetzer HaTov. And because of that, he adds in this pasuk that this melech zaken uchsil, this yetzara, asher lo yada lizaher od. At this later stage in one's life, when one is old, the yetzara in him no longer is able to be careful. What does that mean? It also means, it's also insinuating that an older gentleman may have a harder time changing bad habits. Like they say, I think in English, you can't teach an old dog new tricks. Mm-hmm. Something like that. Yeah. He's old. He doesn't want to change. He's happy the way things are. It is more difficult to change. So, asher lo yada lizaher od, this melech zaken uksil, referring to the yetzera, referring to an older gentleman whose yetzera is old too, may have a harder time changing. So, of course, the best thing to do is to make sure we form habits when we're younger. So, a child who is better off is only, however, better off if he's a chacham, as he said. If he uses his chokhmah, if he uses his sechel, then he's able to work himself up and do battle, continuous battle with the Yetzer Hara for the rest of his life, and Bezat Hashem win. But before bar mitzvah, that would be a little bit too difficult for him to do. It's just to make decisions. That's what life is all about, is decisions. Okay, let's go on. Now he says, okay, we have a good young man here who's a chacham. He's going to win. He's going to succeed. He's going to use proper judgment. And he's going to, all the way throughout his life, Baruch Hashem. He says, it's too bad things don't last. Good things don't last forever. And this is the way he verbalizes it. Ra'itit kol ha'chayim. I looked at all of life. Ha'mehalechim tachat ha'shamesh, that walk under the sun. In other words, I have observed several generations. That's what he's saying. Im ha'yeled ha'sheni, ha'sheyamot tachtav. And I'm already looking at the next generation of the second yeled. Remember the first yeled, chacham? I'm already looking with his son. So what's going to be? Okay, he's a chacham. Now let's look at what's going to be with his children. Right? And he says, you know what? This previous yeled had it all going for him. En ketz lechol ha'am, lechol ha'shayah lifnehem. There's no end to all the people that were there before, in the first generation, during the time of the first yeled. All the good that they had, but gam ha'achronim lo yismechu bo. The pasuk is a little bit hard to understand. That's why we have to learn it together. But the next generation will not be able to benefit from all the good that was around in the first generation. In other words, even though the first generation was smart, had a lot going for them, they had everything they needed, they were successful, resourceful, the next generation, I've seen, that's what he says, I've seen that the next Yeled will not be able to follow through. So because of this, he says, Ki gam ze hebel ve'rayon ruach. He says, it bothered me. This is so vain. This is so, what a shame. What a waste. Ze hebel ve'rayon ruach. It upsets you, he says, to see something like that. Why isn't there continuity? We started off with somebody who was good, who was a chacham. And even so, he says, I have some bad news to tell you. And that is that there may not be continuity in the next generation. The next Yeled will not necessarily be like his father. And that we need to stop for a moment and ask ourselves, why not? Why can't there be continuity? Why don't things progress? Why do things just... things are forgotten, things are just wasted. The commentaries I've seen in various Sefarim explain the downfall of many empires. Did you ever think about it? The Greeks were a great empire, so were the Persians. Believe it or not, even the Persians were once upon a time a great empire. Even them. What about the Egyptians? Sure. Egyptians of today, would you say they're a great empire? What's in Egypt today? How about Spain? Portugal? England was once upon a time greater than they are today. What do they have today? Right? Turkey, the Ottoman Empire. Did you ever think about what happened? Why couldn't they continue to be big empires? What happened? Well, what's the explanation? What happened? Anybody know here Persian history? Babylonian? Okay, if you know Babylonian, well, they were conquered by the Persians. They were destroyed. Some of these countries were not really destroyed. The people continued. Civilization continued. Right? So what happened? Where are the Romans? I mean, they're all over the place today, of course, the Christian Empire. But Italy, Rome, Greece. You know, Greece is almost bankrupt, they say, today.
Yes.
Right? What happened to Greece?
They grew too big.
The philosophers, they were smart, very successful. Remember Alexander, Plato, Aristotle, from that area of the world. So what happened? So the rabbis explain that there was no continuity in the value system. Whatever one generation preached, whatever they taught, was not carried over to the next generation. As soon as the next generation was born and grew, they trampled on the values of the previous generation. There was no emphasis, no dagesh on chinuch, on education. In other words, on improving life, on refining one's character, on all the important things that there should be an emphasis. These things were overlooked. They were not emphasized. What was emphasized is the wrong thing. So there's no continuity. In other words, even if there was something good, obviously there's something good. If they're on top of the world, something they're doing something right. It may not be that they're the biggest tzaddikim. They may not be righteous, but they're doing something right. Look at their rate of success. And there must be a lot of chokhmah, and there must be some sechel, right? They're not just animals, wild savages, right? They must be doing something right. Even militarily, you're attacking, you're invading, there has to be strategy. So what happened? No continuity. The next generation did not follow through with the first generation. Whatever the first generation held to be important, and as a result of that was, for them, successful, it did not last. They did not hold on to the same values of their previous generation. So because of that, we also see in this country and in many other countries that when you have different ruling parties, Democrats, then Republicans, then Democrats, Republicans, Republicans, Democrats, they're very, very different in their outlook, in their way of thinking, in their priorities and in their values and what they consider important. Are we going to invest in social security and in welfare? Are we going to protect this country from competition, economics. Are we going to invade other countries for the interest of America? Supposedly there's an interest. Right? These are important issues. Right? Are we going to allow immigrants to come in? Important questions. Because this can affect the country. In many, many ways, this country is not the same as it was 40, 50 years ago. In many ways, the values are different, priorities are different, and there's no vision. There's no plan, there's no vision.
Demography is different.
Everything, a lot of things changed. You go to France today, you go to England, and you start smelling curry. Nothing wrong with that, you know, curry is actually good for you. But I don't think you could smell curry many, many years ago. I would have to ask you.
I don't think so.
No. Anyway, things have changed there too, right?
Unfortunately.
Yeah, of course, unfortunately.
You know, Rabbi, Indians say geography is history.
Yes.
Honestly.
It's only history, right. So you see how the change of politics, the change of miflagot, of parties, in Israel too. They can't get to agree on anything. Never. They barely ever agree on anything. And that is why the country, of course, has suffered. But the good thing about Israel is that the Knesset doesn't decide everything. Baruch Hashem, the boss, decides. Yeah, he decides how he wants to lead the country. But obviously we have a little bit of a say, and it would look a lot better if we used our sechel. And that sechel, of course, would be guided by the Torah. Otherwise, sechel that's not guided by the Torah is also not necessarily going to lead anywhere. So, unfortunately, Israel also has its problems because of a lack of chazon, a lack of vision, and because of the parties being so splintered. Everybody has their own opinion on how to run the place. Therefore, if you learn Pirkei Avot at the very beginning, the Chachamim make a very strong point, a strong message. And Sheh Knesset Agdola, the assembly of rabbis who were entrusted with the transmission of the Torah, they said, Vasu Siag La Torah, make sure you erect a fence around the Torah. We're transmitting the Torah, make sure you put a fence around it. What's a fence? Anytime you see there's a weakness in the generation, in a certain place, make fences. Make all kinds of decrees and tell people certain things that they need to do in order that they safeguard their Torah. Well, isn't that adding to the Torah? That's not called adding. You're not allowed to add to the Torah. But that's not called adding. That's called protecting it. Protecting what you have from it being lost. From it falling apart. You don't want to, chas v'shalom, that what happened to other cultures, civilizations, and nations should happen to you, right? What is assimilation and intermarriage? You think an Armenian thinks twice whether to marry a Kurd or not? If they fall in love, they fall in love. They like each other. What's the problem? If they're both Muslims, that's even better. The problem is the Armenian many times is a Christian, the Kurd is a Muslim. But if they, you know, that could be the only problem. But they don't have a problem of intermarriage. By us, we do. It will dilute everything. Okay? It would. Everything will fall apart. Chas v'shalom. So we have to have certain safeguards. I don't know if any of you have heard of this, but it's very, very interesting. In the Syrian community of Jews in Brooklyn and in Mexico and in Argentina, at least in these three places that I know of, there's an edict. An edict is like a gezerah, like a decree. Oh, I think the door is locked. Maybe.
I'll open it.
Yeah. There's an edict that you cannot allow anybody who's not a Jew from joining the community, even if they convert, of course. Right? No conversions allowed. Somebody converts, they won't let them into the community. If one of their children goes out with a convert, he's banned from the community. He will not be buried in their cemetery. That is how strict they are. Nothing wrong with a convert who's sincere, who's genuine. We embrace converts. They can become great people, and they're definitely accepted as equals. We have to treat them well. These are all mitzvot in the Torah. 1935, they made a special gezerah when they came to this country not to allow. Is it okay now? Is it open?
Yeah,
okay. I guess it was closed by mistake.
Yeah. Make sure next time you are on time.
Yeah. Okay. So in the Syrian community, they made a decree, an edict, we won't allow our children to marry converts. 1935, many rabbis signed on it. There was a story where one woman was converted in Israel, and she wanted to, of course, marry one of the individuals in the community, and they said, no way. So Rabbi Ovadia Yosef himself came and said, I converted her, I signed my name. They said, no, sorry. They even told him, no. I heard that other rabbis later agreed to it as an exception, but no. Why? Because they saw what was happening to their kids when they came to this country, or the potential of what could happen. They're going to mix. The Syrian Jews are not Ashkenazi Jews who wear black long coats with hats that don't allow goyim to get too close to them. And they don't get too close because they're so different in their way of thinking, in their lives, right? So they're not, the dangers were smaller. They live in a more ghetto, more closed. I'm talking about the Hasidic especially. Other modern Orthodox, of course, is a whole different ballgame. They have their own issues. But the ones who were very strong in the Ashkenazi didn't have to have this kind of a gezerah. They didn't mind occasionally a convert either. Occasionally, if he was sincere, genuine. But the Sephardim, who were businessmen, for the most part, traveling all over the place, right? They have this problem. They may have this problem. No conversions allowed, no marriages to a convert. Even the children of a convert will not be allowed. That is how strict they were. So even though a lot of people don't like that, because they, you know, a lot of converts especially, think, oh, you're being overzealous and too strict and you're not being fair, whatever you want to say, you have to at least admire the fact that this has helped that community stay intact. Very, very, very few have opted to leave the community because of this. Very few have assimilated, very few have intermarried because of this. So, you see, it helped. You know, in Saudi Arabia, they chop off your hand if you steal. Not too many people steal in Saudi Arabia. Yeah. Same thing with Singapore, with drugs. They hang you. Right? In many countries, some crimes are very, very big crimes, considered big crimes, punishable by death. People think about it many, many times before they do it. Why take a chance? If the penalty is great, you don't do it, or you think about it. So that is what the Chachamim meant by Va'asu Siyag LaTorah. Make a fence around the Torah in order to protect the Torah, that there should not be any changes, it should not be infiltrated, and Chas V'Shalom, be weakened. All right, let's go on. Now he goes on to explain a different idea. We spoke about using sechel. We spoke about using proper judgment. And that is our only chance of defeating the Yetzirah, who's there from day one. He's older than us, the Yetzirah, right? So you need to use your sechel, your Yetzer Tov, along with your sechel, proper judgment. You need to think and evaluate the situation before you do it, and not to act impulsively. And that's what he's going to talk about now. How to properly do things. How not to do things without too much thought. How that can get you into trouble. Shmor aglecha kasher tilech el bet ha'elohim. Watch your feet as you go or when you go to the house of God. That could be the Bet HaMikdash, the Bet HaKnesset, the Bet HaMidrash. Whether you go for prayer, whether you go to learn, make sure that when you do go, you watch yourself, that you go with the proper thought, with the proper kavanah. What should that kavanah be? Vekarov lishmoa. Vekarov lishmoa means that you should always go with the intent of listening to what the rabbis will tell you. In other words, if you seek their advice. Karov lishma means that you should pay close attention to what you're being told. That you should consider everything that you hear. And if you go for the intent of doing teshuvah, of repenting and bringing a sacrifice during the time the sacrifices were allowed in the temple, make sure that you don't do it the way the fools do it. Miteta kesilim zavach. Don't do it in the same way that the fools do. Just to bring a sacrifice without doing proper teshuvah, without proper repenting. Proper repentance involves thinking about what you did, feeling sorry about what you did, and then bringing the sacrifice, which is symbolic more than anything else. The confession, the words of remorse are more important than anything else. So don't do it the way the fools do it, out of habit, not with too much thought. Because the fools do not know to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. La sotra, in other words, to them, doing something which is ra is not something that they understand, that they fully comprehend. What did they do so wrong that requires fixing? In other words, they don't think about their actions so much. So you don't be like them. When you go to the Bet Elohim, make sure that you think about it. Why am I going? What is this place? What do I need to do? What do I need to accomplish? Right? That's the importance of thinking. The importance of evaluating the situation, even something like going to shul, going to a house of prayer to pray. You're going to pray, you're going to pray with kavanah. In other words, after all, you're praying. That means you're asking, you're praising, you're not just going to throw words. But sometimes, because of habits, that's what some people do. But that is because of a lack of thought. There's no thought going into what I'm doing. So then I'm just, therefore, doing what I'm accustomed to do every single day, which is no good. That is a foolish way of doing things. Next point. Also, in continuing about doing things without thinking about them before. This is already the beginning of chapter 5, Perek Hamishi. Very important area that involves speech, not necessarily action, but speech. Al tevahel al picha velibecha al yimaher lotzi davar lifnei Elohim. Don't rush to utter, to say things, or to think about saying things, and to say and to speak them before God. What does it mean before God? People may have complaints. Why does God do this? Or why doesn't God do this? If you have complaints about God, be careful. Keep them to yourself. Don't start complaining and saying things. You know why? First of all, Ke Elohim b'shamayim v'ata la'aretz. Hashem is up there and you are here. Well, obviously Hashem is up there and you are here. What is he trying to tell us? What does it mean, Ke Hashem, Ke Elohim b'shamayim v'ata la'aretz? Al ken yu devarecha me'atim, therefore keep your words very few. God is in the Shemaim and we are here. There's various interpretations to these very important words. Hashem is there and we are here. The distance between the land and the heavens is very, very far. In the same way that He is there and we are here and we're so far from each other, the same is true about Da'at, the Da'at of Hashem and the Da'at of a Ben Adam, of a human being. It's so far. We can never comprehend, we can never understand Hashem's ways. His da'at, His way of doing things, His planning, His strategy is so different than ours. We don't come close to understand. We can't figure it out. Just like the distance between land and heaven is so great, so is our distance in our way of thinking. Therefore, don't start complaining, why is there a Holocaust? Why do these tragedies occur? Even though I've always said that there's partial explanations in the Torah for these things, still, some people have a very hard time with it. So don't start complaining, because first of all, you can never figure it out, and don't expect to know, and don't expect to have an answer, because His way, Hashem's way of thinking, is so different than ours. We can therefore never come close to comprehending His ways. That is one explanation of Shamayim and Aretz. Another explanation of Shamayim and Aretz is, He has a better view. And it's true. If you're on top, you can see more. So this is describing how Hashem's observation of matters and affairs in this world is much broader than ours. We are here. And if you are here, הראייה שלך מצומצמת. Your vision is limited. How much can you see if you're here? If you're higher, you can see more. Right? If you were to go up a mountain on a clear day, you may be able to see miles. Many, many miles in the distance. If you're not on the mountain, you can't see. Right? So Hashem, through His Hashgacha over the entire world, is able to know and see everything. And we hear, Hashem Ba'aretz, what do we know? What do we see? Hashem sees generations. Hashem knows thoughts, right? Hashem sees everything. And therefore, He knows best. He knows exactly what's going on. Nothing misses Him. So you have complaints? You don't understand what things are? He understands what things are. He sees them very, very well. That's the second Pirush. Therefore, we're better off, he says, to keep our words few, which means we're better off just keeping quiet sometimes instead of thinking too much into it. But another important idea here that he's telling us is Al tevahel al picha velibecha limaher, is don't rush to conclusions, don't talk too quickly, don't talk before you think, without too much thought. You're about to say something, we're about to do something, we're about to reach a conclusion. Not so fast. Think about it. It may be wrong. You may not have all the information. So don't do anything and don't say anything. We talk pzizut. Pzizut means impulsiveness. Right? Like I told you once, in Arabic and in Farsi, there's a saying, Il-ajal min-ashatan. In other words, rushing comes from the shaitan in Farsi, right? Yes, same idea. Persian, yes. Yeah, that's the Persian version, right? If you do something impulsively, it's coming from the satan. The satan is pushing you to do it, and it's not a very good thing. Okay, what else is not good about doing or talking fast? Sometimes people say the wrong things. If you don't think about it, you're going to make a mistake. And sometimes this mistake can be very, very costly. One of those very costly mistakes the rabbis tell us is Al tiftach peh la satan. Don't open up your mouth to the satan. Don't wish yourself bad. As an example, our forefathers in the desert at one point expressed themselves, Lumatnu! Ah, they wish they would have died in the desert instead of having to go through the struggles that they have to go through now. Hashem says, yeah, you wish? You're going to die in the desert. You asked for it. Be careful not to open your mouth to the satan, not to express something that I wish it would, if it's something negative. Because it may be happening. It may happen. There's a malach. There's an angel specially appointed to pick up words. That's all he does. You know, like you have in the courts, you have, what do they call her?
Recorder.
A recorder that uses shorthand. You know, they have a very good shorthand system upstairs. Everything is recorded, exactly what was said, in color also, 3D, or HD, high definition. Everything is recorded. So you have to be careful what to say. There is a story in the Gemara, in Midrash in the Gemara, about one of the great rabbis, Rabbi Levi. Levi was his name. He was a great man, and there was a year of no rain. It was a long period, a long stretch without rain. Begazar ta'anit, and he decreed that there should be a fast day, like the rabbis used to do when there was no rain for a number of weeks and months. When there should be. No rain came down. So he went over to pray to Hashem and he says, how come you are holding back rain from your kids? How come you treat them like that? How come you give them such a hard time? This was more or less part of his prayer. And the rabbis relate that the end of the story was that immediately after his prayer, rain started coming down, but all of a sudden he became a cripple. In other words, the way he said what he said towards Hashem was wrong. You shouldn't have said it that way. What do you mean Hashem has no pity for his kids? Something like that. Those were his words. How come you don't have pity for your kids? What do you mean I don't have pity for my kids? Of course I do. But you don't know my reasons. So that's not the correct way of saying, Hashem, why do you do things like that? Be careful never to complain to Hashem. To complain to your spouse, maybe once in a while, you know. But even then you have to know how to do it. Otherwise it sounds like you're a nag, right? You don't want too much complaining. But to complain to Hashem, why do you do things like that? I have my reasons and I'm not going to tell you. What do you mean? Be very, very careful. As we still look at this big rabbi. Because the prayer was not said in the right way, it's like he's blaming Hashem. We were blaming him. Is there anybody more compassionate than him? We're his kids, right? So we can never accuse him. Chas v'shalom. Better to keep quiet. Like it says by Aaron, Vayidom Aaron, when his two kids were taken from him, he kept quiet. Another idea is not to accuse Am Yisrael, lo lekatregel Am Yisrael, not to talk negatively about Jews, or there's so many Jews who are like this and like that. That's none of your business. You don't have to give a report to Hashem. He knows exactly what's going on in his world. Don't volunteer information. I'd like to say, when it comes to problems that you see amongst the Jews, take the Fifth Amendment. You know what I mean? Just keep quiet. No comment. Take the Fifth. You don't volunteer information. You know what they tell you when the police take, Chas v'shalom, you know, if it happens to someone who's taken to jail and imprisoned, you have the right to remain silent. Is that what they tell you? Yeah. Why? Why do they tell you you have the right to remain silent? Because whatever you say can be used against you. How do you know about this? Anyway. Yeah.
There are a lot of problems with laws in this country.
Therefore, yeah.
So whatever, yeah. What you just said, I don't like it.
What don't you like?
You're
complaining already?
A lot of laws in this country, whether it's traffic tickets or right. A lot of other things, to Jews, especially, makes no sense.
Oh, okay. I mean, you have a right to question it, you know, to find out and to see what's the motive, what's behind it. But the law is not always fair. You know, this is man-made. It's not made by God. Whenever things are made by man, they're not perfect. Some people benefit, others get hurt from it, possibly. When Hashem does something, it's perfect. Only Hashem can do something perfect. What can we do? That's the world we live in. Another nice idea about, another nice explanation of the words, therefore, whatever you say should be few words. When we speak, when we do speak, we should keep it to the bare minimum. It's talking about prayer. You don't have to give Hashem a grocery list of what you need in the prayer. He knows exactly what you need. Hashem, I need this, I need that, you know, this. Just tell him in general terms, Hashem, you know what I need, please send me. Need to get married, children. But don't start specifying. I want her to be a size 2, and she can't be below 5'4", right? And she has to be blonde with green eyes, right? Don't be specific. Don't ask for too much. Don't tell Hashem what you would like exactly, because Hashem may have something else in mind, first of all. Second of all, he knows exactly what you need. There's no reason to waste words for that. Hashem, this is what I need, approximately, you know the details. You know, that's fine. But to be specific, yudvarecha me'atim. Keep your words brief. You don't have to be specific. Hashem knows exactly what our needs are. Okay, let's go on. What happens to someone who does not think too much before he speaks? And this is something that many of you are going to want to hear about it, but I'm going to save it for next week. And that is dreams. He begins to tell us a little bit about what you should do about a dream. Ignore it, not ignore it. But he talks about it later on a little bit more. And so I'm going to elaborate about dreams, Bezat Hashem Velinne, the next week. But right now he tells us briefly that in the same way that most dreams, Kibah Halom Berov Inyan, it comes with so much confusion, with so many details, with all kinds of things that appear in a dream. Much of it has to do with thoughts. Another part of the dream has to do with one's imagination, wild imagination. And much of it is lies and confusion. Rov berov inyan. Achalom ba berov inyan. It comes with all kinds of things that are all confused together and without any particular order and any sense to it. In the same way, kol kesil berov devarim. The voice, the words that are coming out of the mouth of a fool, is just berov devarim, it's just words, empty words. Nothing that makes any sense. So if you want to sound like that, then talk without thinking. That's what he's saying. You don't want to do that because words will come out of your mouth that you will regret. You will say things that don't make any sense. And they will not be always correct either because you didn't take the time to think about it, to digest it. So just like a dream is muddled, confusing, most dreams, he says, the same is true with speech that was not done with the proper preparation of thought, thinking before you speak. So as far as the halom, the characteristics of the dream, we'll talk about it maybe next week. But here he tells us that one of the characteristics is that many, many dreams are basically nonsense, that you don't have to worry about them. Now he comes to the more dangerous type of speech, and that is making nedarim, promises, which by the way includes shvua, an oath too. He says like this, Ka'asher tidor, when you promise, neder l'Elohim, al te'acher l'shalemo, make sure you don't delay in paying it up. Ki en hefetz b'kesirim et asher tidor shalem. Hashem does not want the fools. In other words, Hashem does not want to deal with fools who say things and never keep what they say. So therefore, whatever you promise, make sure that you pay, that you comply, that you fulfill. So he begins to tell us a little bit about what nedarim are. Nedarim are something very, very powerful. You make a promise, you're using your voice, you're using your mouth, you're using the koach hadibur. And this koach, this power of speech, is what is given to the human being that animals don't really have. It is through this power of speech that we give praise to Hashem. So this koach hadibur has tremendous weight, has tremendous value. So be careful not to misuse it. Making a promise and not keeping it is a misuse, it's an abuse of that special gift called the power of speech. And it's a big avon, as we will soon see. It's a tremendous sin. And he says, you're better off not making. We're going to soon see. You're going to be better off not making ever a neder than making a neder. But if you did make a promise, then make sure that you don't delay. What's delay? So regular promises, you have up to 3 holidays to pay them. Basically a year. If one said he's going to give a certain amount of tzedakah, there was an appeal, he promised, or he took it upon himself and he said that he was going to do it, make sure you give it within the year. You don't want to delay it. I mean, you should give it as soon as you can. But make sure, lo te'acher, not to delay it more than a year, because if you do, if one does, it's a transgression of bali acher, bali achel. In other words, that you are delaying your nether, it's like you're nullifying your promise. So you don't want to have that avon. Besides the fact that it's a big avon for people who constantly make nedarim, promises, and don't keep them. As we will soon see, it can have terrible consequences to his family. This includes all kinds of promises that we tell our friends. Somebody tells somebody, I'm going to buy you something, I'm going to take care of this for you. You said so, then you do it. A lot of people don't keep their word. It's not a neder, it's an aftaha, but it's like a neder, it's similar. You mention something, you promise something to someone, it is a form of neder. One who doesn't keep it is like a fool. In other words, his words have no value. Don't promise what you cannot deliver. But if you, and if you did, even though you don't like it, you're not happy with it, you regret it, still keep it. There are individuals who are more righteous than that. Even if they thought of doing a good deed, they thought of it, they didn't say it even. I thought of it, that's what I'm going to do. That's a good thing, by the way, to get used to. If you thought of something good, go ahead and do it. According to the Kabbalah, when we have good thoughts, they don't last too long. They sometimes come from Shemayim. So it's good to get up right away and take care of it right away. Because that good thought, that good feeling that we had, that excitement, is momentarily, may not come back so soon. So that awakening Mishamayim is something that we should take advantage of. And if we felt good about something, we thought of good doing something, we should act upon it. There's a story, a cute story, of a rabbi who took his son to the tailor to have a suit made for him. And the son was not happy. He was giving the father a hard time. I don't want this doesn't look good on me. So, you know, the tailor was having a hard time measuring, you know, and finishing his job. So the father couldn't control his son. So the tailor tells the son, listen, if you cooperate well, I'm going to make you a special pocket in the front, you know, that not everybody had. You're going to have an extra pocket that nobody else has. So that convinced the son. All right. 2 weeks later, the suit was ready. The father came to pick up the suit and to pay for it. And he takes a look at the suit, and there's no pocket, there's no extra pocket. So he asks the tailor, where's the extra pocket? Oh, I didn't really mean it. I just wanted to convince your child, you know, so you should cooperate. But I never meant to make an extra pocket. I'm willing to pay for it, but you're going to make that extra pocket. You promised my child, I don't want him to learn to lie. I don't want him to learn that it's okay to promise and not to fulfill promises. You told him? You're going to buy him a toy? You're going to buy him a toy. No matter what you tell a child, you promise a child, you give that thing to a child. If you don't want to give it to a child, then don't promise. If you promise, keep it. Otherwise, what kind of a lesson are you giving the child that it's okay to promise and not to keep your promise? I don't want him to grow up like that. So therefore, go ahead and make the pocket, even if I have to pay you extra for it. So he says, Hashem doesn't want fools. Hashem doesn't want fools. He doesn't want people who are not serious, who constantly need ziruzim, who constantly need to be reminded, you know, to do things that they said that they would do. Be diligent yourself. Be aware of your own promises, of your own duties, and don't wait till people have to remind you. Otherwise, I mean, that's the behavior of a fool. Who needs others to let him know, oh, didn't you say this? Isn't this what you wanted to do? Hashem doesn't want to deal with these kind of people. However, the best thing is, whenever you do make a promise, or something that sounds like a promise, always say, Beli Neder. Always say, Beli Neder. Maybe, perhaps, I'm not sure, I hope so, Beli Neder, without promising. Be'ezrat Hashem, Inshallah. Right? You can say that, but say Beli Neder.
In Persian, we have a peach.
Yeah, okay, that's without the promising yet.
Yes.
Yes, that's the correct way. In this way you're saving yourself from making Nedarim. There's an interesting pasuk in Mishlei. Mishlei, as you know, was also written by Shlomo Melech, and for anyone who's interested, I gave a series about it several years ago. And you can get the entire series of Mishlei, I think, on one CD.
Right.
Right? It's available in EnglishTorahTapes.com. Very interesting series.
Or also, you can go online.
Yeah, do it. You can download them. Very interesting series about all kinds of important lessons in life, written by Shlomo Melech too. And this is what he says there. Sfat emet ikol na'ad. A lip who speaks the truth will endure forever. What does that mean? Words that are said in truth, in other words, individuals who are always known to be speaking the truth, people will always trust them. Tikol ma'ad, his lips, will always be relied on. People will always believe what he has to say. They will always believe him. But the next portion of the pasuk, ve'ad argi'a leshon shaker. Lashon Shaker will be Argi'ah. Argi'ah is Lashon Rega. People who talk lies, who say lies, they may only be believed for the moment, but the people will not trust them forever. On the contrary, the rabbis tell us, do you know what the punishment of a liar is? Ma'on sho shel badai, I think it is over there. What's the punishment of a liar? That even when he speaks the truth, they don't believe him. There's also, in Italian also, al bugiardo non si crede la verità. In Italian they say, a individual who speaks, who's a liar, they never believe him even when he says the truth. That's his punishment. People who know an individual to be a liar, if that's his reputation, they will not even believe him when he says something that is true. Another idea, but this already has to do with the next pasuk, on how serious making a promise and not keeping is with the following pasuk. First, let's read the next pasuk. Tova shelo tidov mishetidov velo deshalem. You're better off that you don't make a promise than making a promise and not paying it. Just don't make the promise. Who needs your promise if you're not going to pay it? However, there are times, the reason why he says this, I mean, it's obvious you're better off not promising. The reason why he says that is that because there are times that you want may promise, and it's good to promise. Anybody know when that is?
Life is in danger.
Right. When you are be'etzara, you're drowning in the sea. That is a good time to make a promise. Hashem, if you take me out of the water, you save my life, I promise this is what I will do.
Or God forbid if you're sick.
Somebody who's very, very sick. Somebody who's in jail. You get me out of jail? Right? I plan, lin neder, this is what I will do. Something meaningful. Not I'm going to make you a cheesecake or something like that. No, you know, not something, no, I'm going to do this. I'm going to give $18 for tzedakah. No. Mm-hmm. Something meaningful. Really significant.
But even $18 for stock is meaningful.
Of course. Yeah, especially if he has nothing. But what if he's a millionaire? Yeah. Could you believe it that I've known people who were very sick with cancer who didn't want to make any neder even though they were dying? I don't understand. Take upon yourself, lady, to light candles before Shabbat. I'm talking about women that don't do that. Take it upon yourself not to do work on Shabbat. Take it upon yourself to go to the mikveh for the women. Take it upon yourself to put on tefillin. Take it upon yourself to put on tzitzit. Something that you haven't been doing, but commit yourself and do it regularly. That may save the day, and people have been helped. This is not just hocus pocus. This is real. Because Hashem sometimes waits for this. Hashem, if you give me a child, somebody doesn't have children, this is what I plan to do. I'll do this. Right? If somebody has a very difficult time in some area, nodrim be'etzara, the rabbi tells you, you'll make a neder be'etzara. Still, it's advisable to say b'li neder, because we're careful. Chaz v'shalom, avonot is very, very serious. It's a very, very big sin. So that's why he says, you're better off not doing it than doing it even if you keep it. But at times, there are situations where a neder may help the individual. The next pasuk says, one of the very bad consequences of chas v'shalom making a neder is al titen et picha lachati et besarcha. Don't allow your mouth to hurt your flesh. Wow, how is it going to hurt my flesh? A person that makes nedarim and he doesn't keep them, his wife can die. Chas v'shalom. Besarcha means one's wife, one's own flesh. Remember before we talked about don't open your mouth to the Satan? Right? Don't, in very similar to this, don't say something that from your mouth that may hurt your flesh. Yaakov hurt his flesh with Rachel. Anybody that stole your terafim, your idol, Lavan, should not live. He did not know Rachel stole them. So I heard in a nice explanation. How do we know Yaakov realized that this was not the right thing to do? How do we know later on he was much more careful in the way he spoke? When he heard from his kids that the ruler of Egypt was giving his sons a hard time and accusing them of traitors, he could have easily said, Let him die. Let him be cursed. He would be cursing his own son, Yosef. So he didn't say that. Be very, very, very careful in what you say, no matter who it is, because you may be hurting yourself. So that's what he means. Al titen et picha lachati et besarcha, your own flesh. You may be hurting your own flesh if you don't keep your promises. If you say things that eventually may come around like a boomerang. ואל תאמר לפני המלאך כי שגגה היא, למה יקצוף האלוהים על קולך וחיבל את מעשי ידיך? And don't later say before the angel, oh, it was a mistake, I didn't really mean it. Why should Hashem be upset at your voice for having uttered something wrong and then destroy your מעשי ידיך? What's this malach doing over here? Because we said before that there is a malach, there is an angel that hears, that records, and says, on every curse that somebody curses himself or others, amen. Yeah, amen. So chaz v'shalom. You don't want that amen if it's something that's going to hurt you. So therefore, later on, don't use the excuse, I didn't mean it. It was just a shegagah. It was only for fun. It was only a joke. No, there's no such a thing as a joke. Right? Don't allow your mouth to say something that you're going to regret. You know, as the rabbis tell us, before I speak, I control my words. After I have spoken, the words control me. I can't take them back. Now this avon, this sin of nedarim, is explained very well in the Midrash by the following mashal. Because here he told us that we're better off not making promises, then making promises, even if we keep the promise. It's a machloket in the Gemara, because one rabbi says, if you keep the promise, it's a very good thing. Yeah, but because of the chances that you may not keep it, that's why the conclusion in the Gemara is, you're better off, like Kohelet says, not making, than making, and even if you keep it. So there's a nice mashal that explains this. There was once an individual who was given a tour of a prison. And in the prison, he sees three individuals. One of them is in a dungeon, very, very narrow place. Another one is hard labor. And the third one is having a very good meal, enjoying himself in very comfortable quarters. And he says, what did this one do? He said, this one, he owed a lot of people money, and he simply went bankrupt and couldn't pay them. You know, so the creditors, you know, complained, sued him in court. And since he couldn't pay, he landed in jail. Why is he being treated so well? Because it wasn't his fault. I mean, he went bankrupt. It happens, you know, he lost everything. So he thought of a great idea. The next day he went to a restaurant and ordered the big meal. And he didn't pay. When he was asked, why don't you pay? Well, I don't have any money to pay. So why did you order? Well, I ordered, whatever, I ordered. I thought it would be, but I don't have the money. What are you going to do about it? What, I'm going to take you to jail. So that's what he wants. You know, they're going to put him in jail. He's going to have a good meal. They put him in the dungeon. And they started beating him. He said, why are you beating me and putting him in the dungeon? That guy also didn't pay. So how can you compare yourself to that guy? That guy was in business for many years. It happens sometimes that you lose money. You can't pay off your debts. It's not his fault. But you knew you didn't have the money to begin with. How dare you go bother? How dare you go borrow? How dare you go buy something, right? When you know you can't pay, you're going to get the harshest punishment. When you know you can't keep something, right? Don't make a neder. If you have any doubts, if you're going to be able to keep it, why make a neder? You don't have to make a neder. Who asked you to make a neder? The Torah doesn't tell you to make nedarim. Hashem says, you have enough mitzvot. You want to now take more? Keep those. Neder, you don't need to, right? It's like you don't need to do this. If you do this, you're going to get into trouble if you don't keep it. That is nice mashal understanding of why neder, if you really don't have to make one, don't make one. Stay away from it.
You say believe neder.
Always say
that's number one.
Right.
Number two, if you give tzedakah and you say that, like example, kupas ear,
right,
I always see your shoes.
Yes. Sure.
If you have a home, I can tell you one fast story. But
yeah, quick story, sure.
I was once had a nail in my foot. I was climbing up a ladder, and I'm a diabetic, and my foot got swollen. And the doctor scared me and said, I may have to amputate the limb. So I immediately pledged I would give $25 to Kupas a year, a terrific charitable, And then they scheduled me for another doctor. She said, all you need to do is just bandage your leg and put it out up on the bed for a couple of days, and your leg will be fine. It's unbelievable.
Yeah,
the
sure,
doctor
sure.
scared
sure.
me. And by getting stuck, I was saved.
Well, Hashem, yeah.
I didn't mean to...
No, very good. Yeah. But this happens, like we said before.
Yeah.
You make an... but still say Beli Neder, even if you're going to give tzedakah. It could be very helpful, but still say Beli Neder. The last idea that I wanted to discuss tonight, which involves diburim asurim. Diburim, when we talk about speech that is forbidden, we're not only talking about nedarim that should not be made, or promises that are not kept. It also includes foul language. It also includes lies. Anything that is going to be damaging to your mouth. But the one that really needs to be spoken about briefly is Lashon Hara. Lashon Hara is a very, very big avon, and that is to talk negatively, even if it's true. Lashon Hara is not sheker, even if it's true, about individuals. And there's a lot of halachot, and we cannot review all of the halachot right now. The Chafetz Chaim came out very, very strongly about learning, the importance of learning, so that we know what we can say and what we cannot say. There are many times we're in a situation where we don't know if we can say what we would like to say. The general rule is, if it's something not nice that you're going to say about something, think over 1,000 times before you say it. The chances are, more likely than not, that it's going to be Lashon Hara. Unless you're really trying to save a person from becoming a partner with somebody who's not honest. Things like that, where you may have to tell them the truth. Otherwise, be very, very careful not to talk negatively, unless there is a reason for it. There's some reason to say it, some reason, but not because you're upset, not because you're angry at him, not because you know. Otherwise, when you say something negative about a person, it's called Lashon Hara. And people don't understand the severity of this. They have to be very, very careful in giving people the benefit of the doubt, looking at all the sides of the issue. And you're allowed to tell people the problem you have with someone. I have this problem. Right? But not to start to begin to talk about all the negative things that he has done. What is that going to add? It's just going to create more enmity, more hatred, right? More divisiveness in Am Yisrael. So we have to. Lashon Hara is a very, very big avon. That's what's holding back Mashiach, according to many Kabbalists today. The Sinat Chinam, the basis of hatred. And that is why the Chafetz Chaim came out with this. This is something that we have to work on. Be very, very careful. And this, of course, is important to begin at one's home. One's home and one's dining room table, where much is being said about all kinds of people and what's going in the town. And what did she say? What did she do? And what did he buy? And what did she buy? Who cares? It's not important. It's totally not important. And it's dangerous, because one thing leads to another. Even if you say, okay, they just bought a new house. Oh, that could lead to something very negative. Oh, he bought a new house, but he owes money. You know, it can easily, anything that you think is nice can easily lead to something negative about the person. So you have to be very, very careful, even when talking nice about a person, that you don't overdo it, because that could lead to a negative remark. So Lashon Hara is a very, very big avon. The Kabbalah, the Mekubalim tell us that a person who never did teshuvah for Lashon Hara comes back reincarnated in a dog. This is learned from the pasuk, La'kelev tashlichun oto, basa basadet trefa. That person who speaks Lashon Hara is sent to the dog. Sent to the dog means that he comes reincarnated in a dog for an atonement. It's a terrible avon that, I'm telling you, requires a tremendous amount of caution. One who wants to do the proper teshuvah for this, of course, has to approach the individual who we spoke about, ask for forgiveness, appease him. Yom HaKippurim was not enough. Yom HaKippurim will not atone for sins ben adam v'chaveru. You have to actually approach the individual whom you offended, insulted, spoke bad about, Lashon Hara and so forth. What if he's dead? You go to his grave. Or if it's too far, if he's in Isfahan, right? Then you have to send a mission. You have to send people who are there, who are living there, right? And they go to the grave, right? And ask forgiveness at the grave. Just because he's dead doesn't mean that's it. He's gone. It's still hurtful. It's still hurtful. You know, there have been stories of people who, of course, have hurt others, and they are dead, the ones that hurt. They had to somehow come in a dream and ask forgiveness. They had to somehow, you know, do something to ask forgiveness from those individuals who they offended. And sometimes it's very difficult, because if it was done in public, go bring back all the people who were assembled at the time who heard you say what you said. You don't know who heard it. In the meantime, they've acquired a terrible impression of this individual. And that is why words are very dangerous. They are more hurtful. They do more harm than sticks and stones, than knives, than bullets. As the rabbis tell us, a bad reputation, bad words being spoken in Israel can kill somebody in Spain. There's no bullet that travels so far to Spain. I mean, a missile maybe, but right? You can't kill somebody standing in Israel and shooting at him in Spain. But words being said here, they travel everywhere. They can be very, very hurtful. So obviously this is a tremendous area that one has to be careful with. These are some of the ideas of what he means when he says, watch your mouth before you speak, think about it. Not only in communicating your thoughts, not only in giving a speech, not only in making comments, remarks, and so forth, but in giving an opinion about an individual, and of course between a husband and a wife, you know, obviously these remarks, words can be very, very harsh, very painful, and very hard to take back, very hard to fix. So all of these kind of situations involves the dibur, which is a very, very powerful tool, and therefore one has to be very, very cautious in handling it properly. Thank you.